So one last time, to wrap this all up, the president is enforcing a policy, his own administration's policy, even though he says he hates it, and even though it is his administration's power to stop it if he wanted to. Yet, he says separating families is the Democrats' fault because Democrats won't come to the table and negotiate on immigration, even though they have. So now that you have the facts, I want to bring in my next guest, Republican Congressman Will Hurd of Texas. He toured a facility last night and is joining us now live. Congressman, thank you for being here with us. First, what is your impression of this center that you had a chance to look at?
Well, we went there last night about 9:30. It's in my district, and to me, it makes it very clear that in the home of the free and the land of the brave, we should not be using kids as a deterrent policy. This is something I think is actually unacceptable, and it's something that as Americans we shouldn't be doing. And this really isn't a Republican or a Democrat issue. This is an issue about how should you treat children. And that's something that I saw last night.
And that's why I think a lot of people are outraged, for one, and also baffled about why the president, who says he hates what he sees is happening, is continuing to allow it to happen.
Well, this is clearly something that the administration can change. They don't need legislation to change it. They don't need Democrats in order to change it. This is a Department of Justice policy, and this is something that's being enacted by HHS. One of the things I did learn when I was there was there's still a lot of questions that are unanswered about what is actually going on. The kids in Tornillo are 16 and 17-year-old boys. These are kids that have been in other facilities in other parts of the country that have been moved to this facility in order for room to be made for the kids that are being separated from their parents. Now, the question that I've had for HHS is, how do the parents that are separated from their kids know where their kids are? How does the kids know where their parents are? How long is this policy going to last? Is it having the intended effect that the administration wanted to have? There's a lot of folks that aren't talking to one another within the administration on the ground in El Paso. There's a lot of people that didn't know what it was indeed going on at this one facility and knew even less about the policies that were generating this kind of behavior. And ultimately, what we need to be doing to secure our border, it is 2018, we don't have operational control of our border. But we shouldn't use a fourth century tools like a 30-foot high concrete structure and tent cities to solve a 21st century problem. We need additional immigration judges in order to apply consequences to people that are violating the law. There are alternative forms of detention that have proven to be more effective and a lot cheaper to enact. Those are the kinds of things that we should be looking at. Where was the analysis that was done by HHS and DOJ when they decided to take this one path over others? These are still some of the questions that I have even after having toured this facility.
So you just laid out a lot of questions, but a lot of ideas and points in there. First is that immigration, the bigger immigration legislation that I know Congress is working on. So I'll ask you about that in a follow-up. But getting back to just this issue at hand with the children and parents being separated at the border and now being dispersed to different detention facilities or holding facilities, whatever you want to call them. You talked about Tornillo, Texas, and this temporary facility that's been erected there. And you don't have answers to the questions that you were asking about whether the federal officials who are doing this separation are now tracking where the families are going and have a sense of whether they are even in contact with each other once the parents and children are separated?
That's correct. And that's an issue that folks back in Washington, D.C. have to figure out. Let me be clear. The Tornillo facility has 16 and 17-year-old boys that are considered unaccompanied minors. When they came into this country, they were by themselves. And they were in other facilities that were state-approved and state-run. And they got taken out of those facilities and moved to Tornillo. So on site in Tornillo, there are folks that are working with them on trying to find a family member, whether in the United States or back in their home country. They have access to pro bono legal services, things like that. But this is a symptom of a larger problem, and that larger problem is that we're taking kids out of the hands of their family. Mm-hmm. We know from October 2017 to April of this year, there were 700 kids that were separated from their parents. 100 of those were kids that were under the age of 4. And so they were taken away probably for the first time to be away from their mother and father. I don't think anybody thinks that's acceptable behavior in an industrialized country. And so we also know that over the last 2 months that DOJ has separated 2,000 kids from their parents. And again, all these questions still exist. And if we have to separate kids from their parents, then we probably need to rethink our strategy on how we're securing our country. Let's take Coast Guard. Coast Guard is only able to action 25% of the known drugs they know that are coming in this country, which means 75% is not being actioned. Let's put some more resources in Coast Guard. Let's make sure that we're using technology along the border to aid the men and women in Border Patrol. I have more border than any member of Congress, 820 miles of border. These are some of the smart solutions that we should be doing to make sure we actually have operational control of our border. And let's make sure we have more immigration judges and address the root causes in places like Honduras and El Salvador and Nicaragua. These are all better paths forward that we can work together in a bipartisan way and ultimately to solve. This problem is too complicated to try to solve it by one party by themselves.
Yeah.
We actually have to work in a bipartisan fashion.
Well, and what you're saying is what we are also hearing from a number of Democrats. It sounds like you agree on a lot of issues, Republicans and Democrats, and yet we aren't seeing anybody working together. In fact, my understanding is the Republican bill that has been negotiated between conservatives and moderate Republicans in the House has only been dealing with Republicans at the table. No Democrats were invited into that negotiation, which, again, I don't understand why, but the president could end what's happening right now at the border with the separation of families and children, the children and parents, with a stroke of a pen in a single tweet. Will you call on the president to end this practice now?
I have, and I continue to do that. And I just make one correction in your previous statement. There is a bipartisan piece of legislation on solving border security and DACA specifically, and does things that addresses issues like catch and release and ultimately the problem of having to detain so many people. It's called the USA Act, and it's something that I've been working on with Pete Aguilar from California. And we have 30 Republican co-sponsors, 30 Democratic co-sponsors. This was the bill that we were working on, this Queen of the Hill scenario, in order to move forward. So there is bipartisan legislation that has been negotiated between Republicans and Democrats. Good question. You got to ask somebody else, because that's what we're working on trying to get done. I do believe that if it were brought to the floor to the House, that it would pass in overwhelming fashion with Republicans and Democrats.
Congressman Will Hurd, thank you very much for taking the time. We appreciate it.